BBC Audio presents Mitchell on Meetings, where comedian David Mitchell invites us, via Zoom, to investigate the story of how the humble meeting took over the world and what we should do about it.
Almost a decade ago, one Saturday in October, 500 protesters turned up in the square beside St. Paul's Cathedral. This was the London version of the Occupy movement, and they were there to set up camp. It was quite a scene. The anti-capitalists with their chants and banners, the famous old cathedral, and all in the middle of the City of London, the square mile led by a Lord Mayor and his livery companies, and full of banks. So the stage was set, the protesters, the church, and the city in this rather symbolic tableau. And what happened next? Well, after the protesters had worked out if it was still okay to get lunch from Pret, and the church people had cast worried looks skyward, and the city people had checked the markets, there was really only one thing they could do.
We called a meeting.
Yeah, I think we had a meeting.
A meeting, I guess.
So they all did the same thing. Not together, of course.
It kind of spooked the authorities, both the City of London and St Paul's at first.
This is Pete Broadbent, the Bishop of Wilsdon in northwest London.
They retreated into the chapter house, which is behind the cathedral, sat at their big long oak table and had a formal meeting at which different views were expressed about how on earth you deal with this on your doorstep.
So they essentially met under the setting of a costume drama, really, where people in the 17th century would meet for a meeting.
Indeed, you're surrounded by pictures and portraits of the deans all around the walls. It's got a very formal atmosphere. It's what you might think of as a classic church-type meeting. And meanwhile, outside, 500 people were deliberating in a very different way.
So on the first day, there wasn't even a microphone. It was just people on the steps.
Kat Brogan, a poet and teacher and one of the activists who was there from the start of the protest.
And someone was speaking, and then I would literally just repeat what they had said to further down the crowd, like without a microphone, just with my loud voice. I think what was really new about it was the hand signals. There was an agreed communication method, almost like if you were diving.
They had signals for agreeing, for disagreeing, for raising a point of order and for voting. And there was the one that Kat describes as the rolling sea kind of signal, tumbling your hands over in the air, which meant hurry up and get to the point. The Occupy movement's meetings were designed to be different. Whether they were any better at getting things done, we'll leave that to others. But the church, the city, the protesters, they all met a lot.
I honestly really don't like meetings, and I try to avoid them like the plague if I possibly can.
A bishop. Is that a meetings heavy job?
Oh, I mean, we spend half our life in meetings.
He spends half his life in meetings. And as we all know from bed adverts, we spend nearly half our lives asleep. So if you add a bit of time for eating, that's basically a meeting, eating and sleeping lifestyle. What time is left for doing the things we plan to do in the meetings? People talk so much about spending all day at work in meetings. It's meeting after meeting after meeting. The meeting ran on. Oh, I've got another meeting. Thursday is all meetings. What are these meetings for? We meet to discuss doing things, but no one ever refers to the time spent then doing the things the meetings have decided. You might get the impression, listening to these programmes, that I'm someone who doesn't particularly relish the prospect of a meeting. And you'd be right. I'm certainly a meeting sceptic. But talking to people during the COVID restrictions has been an opportunity to reflect on the aspects of meetings that aren't about their ostensible purposes. How we come together, the rhythm of our lives, and how it's helpful to sit in a room with fellow humans and realise they aren't quite as annoying as we sometimes imagine them to be. But of course, meeting in the time of COVID doesn't mean meeting. We've taken the meeting out of meeting, and what's left? Zoom. And because of Zoom, the mundane meetings that make up daily life have got a bit more attention. Handforth happened.
They now elect a chairman.
No, they can't, because the vice chair's here. I take charge.
And the man who appeared for a meeting on screen as a cat.
I'm here live. I'm not a cat.
And the man who was upside down.
I'm sorry, Mr. Emmer?
Yes.
Are you okay?
I am.
You're upside down, Tom.
I don't know how to fix that.
It's been a strange few months. So how did we reach the evolutionary point where we're gathering to shout at each other on screens in the name of local democracy? The Dutch sociologist Wilbert van Vree has spent a lifetime studying the story of meetings, from the campfire to Zoom. He wrote a book called Meetings, Manners and Civilization: The Development of Modern Meeting Behaviour. Thanks for doing this.
Thanks for having me.
If you want a five-minute history of several millennia of meetings, Wilbert is your man.
I'm waiting for your questions.
Broadly speaking, he says it goes like this. Hunter-gatherers met around a campfire to talk things over and make plans. Then, as communities settled and got bigger, groups of warriors and priests started to hold their own meetings.
They made the most important decisions about life and death, about war or no war, what to do in case of calamities like fire or flooding or whatever. So those warrior councils became models.
And in the Middle Ages, I believe in some European countries, meetings were known as a thing.
Yes.
And is that the same root as a thing, as in an object or a...
I think so, yeah.
And is that a sign that it was something fundamental? If it's a thing, you know, people talk now about parties or gatherings or a launch. Some nebulous event might be referred to as a thing. There's some sort of thing tonight. Are you going to the thing later? But the earliest thing was a meeting.
Yes, yes. And that was the name of it. That kind of relatively small meetings of armed men, former warriors.
And how did they stop at these things? If everyone's turning up with weapons, how did they stop it degenerating into a fight?
Well, there could be violence in the meeting itself, too. I think that one of the developments of meeting history is that the meetings became more and more peaceful. It was a big problem to have enough self-control at moments that the temperature increased and your enemy is there, too, and what are you going to do? So there was a very strong rule in those meetings, those things, to not exercise any form of violence.
So the way the things would work is that violence becomes taboo. Because here in Britain, because we're tremendously antiquarian in so many ways, in our parliament, all of the MPs, they still have, as well as a hook for their coat, they have a special hook for their sword. Uh-huh. The convention was that you don't go into parliament with your sword, because obviously there's a risk people start drawing them and settling the issues through violence. And they still have a sword hook now. It's this sort of ancient taboo against violence in the meeting place.
Yeah. A good example of what we talked about is our chairman's gavel. It developed from a double-bladed axe, I think.
Oh.
That was used in those things to keep order.
So it's a vestigial axe. The gavel that makes people shut up used to be the axe that really made people shut up.
Exactly. And then you see the axe is more a weapon. A gavel is more civilized.
Although you can do quite a lot of damage with a gavel, I'm sure.
Sure, you can, but it's not so sharp as an axe.
Definitely. I would prefer a beating with a gavel to a beating with an axe.
Exactly. Yes. So that's in general.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.